Let's go to a video in which a very interesting woman who's in the audience, and we'll get a yes, it's Tanya. We'll get a microphone down to Professor Tanya Munro, but let's see the video first.
The role of IPAS is to bring together researchers from different disciplines to solve real problems. The research done in universities is usually siloed within disciplines. We wish to break that. Our aim is to tackle some of the hardest challenges that we face as a society, and the only way you can do that is by bringing together scientists with different backgrounds. As soon as you start working between the traditional sciences, you generate new knowledge, but when it's really exciting is when it solves practical problems. The greatest impact that IPAS research has is when we work hand in hand with industry solving real problems. A really critical factor in success of this strategy is bringing industry together with research. It's critical that we create networks and active projects, that we increase the capability of researchers to go and work in industry and create options for industry to come in and understand what research can offer to them.
Okay, Tanya, can I get you to stand up? And first of all, you can reflect on what you've been hearing. But also, I have a question for you just to start off, and that is... come out. They can see you there. Do you have any case studies where an idea has been taken from the lab, from the university, to manufacturing, or is in the process of being taken?
Look, we do have examples where things are coming out of the lab and making a difference in industry. And some of the examples from my own labs are new optical fibres that are being used to essentially diagnose the health of structures and bridges and new medical diagnostics that are starting to come out. But one thing I've observed is that linear, old-fashioned view that something starts out in a lab and if it gets through various hurdles might possibly one day be a commercial reality, that's being overturned. I think we have a new paradigm where a really challenging question or need from industry can actually drive research in the other direction. And we have one amazing example in our own lab where working with DSTO and defence industry to develop a dipstick for the quality of fuel, a very practical problem, has actually led to the development of tools that can monitor developing embryos in an IVF machine. So things don't necessarily go in a linear progression that I think people think about as commercialization of research. Hard, challenging, practical problems drive innovation, and that often has unexpected outcomes.
Yeah, just reflect too on what barriers there are to making all this happen in a small state. I mean, do you think you actually require, as Frank was saying, loan money, seed money from governments to make things like this happen? Is capital available in other markets?
Look, I'll take that in two quick parts. One, I've been listening with great interest to some of the optimism around Tonsley, and I think that's wonderful and is a great opportunity. However, that tackles only a small fraction of our research capacity in this state. Fundamentally, the majority of our amazing research capacity here sits within institutions that do not prioritise or even talk about commercial impact as being a value that they acknowledge or appreciate. That's one thing I think is really important to face up to straight away. The second of which is capital. I think it is a huge barrier here. There are relatively few people willing to invest in early stage ideas, and we need to get that conversation going between people who are in the position to finance and those with ideas and a passion and energy. So I think that is a real issue we face.
I'm going to bring Joran here in because your report points to some of these things, and there are ways in which governments can actually make these connections work better. I mean, you even talk about having teams of people sitting down talking about what innovations are out there, actually building a kind of system where scientists talk to bureaucrats who talk to business people. Tell us about that.
I think the key issue is that in modern economies, which are incredibly fast-moving and incredibly diverse, it's about connections. It's the ability for people to communicate with each other, to trigger ideas and have ideas triggered. And that's fundamental, and somebody needs to instigate that. And to face it, my experience here when I came early was that this is one of the most confrontational cultures I've ever come across. You know? People on the whole don't want to talk to the neighbor because they may give him an edge, and it's better not to talk to anybody. So there's a whole issue about doing that, and I do think that
we have a cultural problem then.
Absolutely.
Are we growing out of it, do you think? Or?
Well, it's, as I said, this is a crisis not to be wasted. There is a huge opportunity to make changes when life is difficult. And I do think there are issues there. But I also think there are issues about reflecting on when things are, if I may for a second. Research is great. Basic research is fantastic. The average societal return, all studies show us, is about 30%, okay? Give or take. That's not a bad return. Applied research is even better, but it can't live without basic research. Right? Applied research has a return, give or take, if you look at studies, of about 300%. So there is a big difference between the two, but they are not separated. They are interlinked in this area. And research has to be both curiosity-driven and demand-driven. And in order to have demands, you need to have an understanding of what the problems are, you know, in this sense. And to summarize that in very simple ways, the task for firms is to come up with a problem that matters. Then the issue becomes how to solve it. You know, if universities can help businesses to come up with problems that matter, that's even better, you know, in this sense. But the money is not about solving the problem. The money tends to be collected by the guy that come up with the problem that matters, you know, in this sense. And we have to be better at that. I have never seen a country that is as good at solving problems as Australia is. You've been proud of it, you know, it's the outback mechanic approach. But it's a reactive version. That is not innovation. Innovation is the ability to reflect carefully of the problem that the guy doesn't know that he has, and then come up with a solution that when he sees it, say, wow, I really want that one. Now that's a long-term process, which is a different way of thinking than problem solving. And we have to become very, very good at those type of areas.
Raymond wants to get in, but before we do that, I just want to—I've steered away from Alf, not deliberately, for a little while. But I'm just—you're listening to this now, and I'm just wondering if you're reflecting a little bit on your earlier response. I mean, there is a general sense that cooperation is necessary at different levels. And things can't be done without cooperation with scientists and with governments and with business working together. Your initial response was, well, business needs to stand on its own 2 feet and do things in its own way and work in the markets. Are you changing that view listening to this discussion?
No, I still stand by my view. I don't believe it is a university responsibility or a government responsibility to create a market demand or a business demand. I'm a great supporter of R&D. In my time with the Chefnaca Vision Systems, we did a lot with the Auto CRC functions around Australia, great initiatives. But I agree with Joran, you need a market demand. You need to solve an issue that is relevant to the market such that then manufacturing can back in and create value within and without the business. So our biggest issue we have today for Detmold Packaging is actually how to keep a French fry crisp for the time you leave McDonald's to go home to feed your kids. You know, that's our biggest R&D project.
Could you work on how to make it healthy?
Healthy? not my issue. We just produce. But I'm totally behind the fact that in work with other industries. Also, when you talk about manufacturing and you have supply chain elements, there's a lot of people here that freight product in and out. And a couple of years ago, one of our board members said, well, why don't we organise a big conglomerate so you can get the best rate to? So all those procurement initiatives and supply chain initiatives, I think it's important that we talk and we get the best deal for South Australia. But everything needs to have a relativity back to the market. That's my key point.
Good reality check. Raymond.
No, I agree that I think the focus needs to be on the market, and I think the focus of every business needs, you know, we should get rid of the phrase that we're South Australian businesses. See, we're all global businesses that happen to be located in South Australia. And the globe is our market, and, you know, obviously the near globe is our market, particularly up north. And I think to look at marrying that market demand with whatever our competencies are, not necessarily what we currently do, but what are we really good at that can therefore create real products or real solutions for which real people will pay real money because it solves a real problem.
Okay, it's